Let us pray together. Our Heavenly Father, the songs that we have already sung have preached to our souls. As we open our Bibles this morning to Hebrews, we confess with the songwriter, nothing can compare with Christ. And we pray that we will see him this morning, even as we prayed in that song, show us Christ. Where else can we go? Where else can we go? You alone, O God, have the words of eternal life. So we draw near to you this morning to listen to you speak. And we pray that as you speak, you will soften hearts and that, Lord, we will believe. As, Lord, we pray, help our unbelief. May we trust in Christ, for he is our God and our Lord. We do pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm sure that you will agree with me that comparison is part of our nature. If you were to look back to the time you got up this morning to this point in a day, I'm sure that you have already made comparisons. That's the things that are inbuilt in us. We make decisions based on the things that we compare, and we choose one option that we believe is better than the other. The very clothes you are wearing this morning, you compared and you made a decision as to what is better for this day, for this weather, and for this time of worship. You're going to continue to make those comparisons even after you left this service this morning. So the writer of Hebrews appeals to that inbuilt nature, because we are creatures that are given that ability to compare and decide. And so he is again going to appeal to that comparative spirit within us and help us to see what is better. And as we have introduced Hebrews last week, I told you that the writer of Hebrews is making comparison, and we saw in chapter 1 that he compared Christ with angels. And more so, he compared Christ with those who have gone before in the Old Testament, especially in terms of revealing the message or the truth of God. We learned last week from Hebrews 1, verse 1 to 4, that Jesus is God's final word. Now, we asked ourselves, what makes Jesus the final word? Well, what makes Jesus the final word is because of who he is, who God actually says Jesus is. He is the heir. God has appointed him as heir of all things. That's what we saw. He is the creator of everything. And he upholds his creation by the word of his power, as we have seen. But what even makes him greater is that Jesus is the Son. He is the Son of God. That's what makes him the heir of all things. And I pointed it out that Jesus Christ possesses both believers and unbelievers. He possesses believers as inheritance, and they will share eternity with him in glory. But he also possesses unbelievers in that, as we saw in Psalm 2, that he will crush them if they're not going to turn to him. In appealing to us in that way, the writer of Hebrews wanted us to listen to the Son of God. Long ago, after God spoke to the fathers by the prophets in many portions and in many ways. In these last days, he has spoken to us in his Son. And his message, we know that is greater than the message brought to us by angels. And the message brought to us by angels is the law. The law, as we read in Acts 7, was delivered by angels. The writer of Hebrews is appealing to us in Hebrews 2 as he applies what he has brought in chapter 1. As he brings that to application, he said to us, we should not drift from what we have heard. And we should actually apply what we have heard by listening, by paying closer attention to what we have heard. So it's because if the message that was brought or spoken by angels received a just penalty, how will we escape if we neglect such a great salvation that was brought to us by even the greater messenger of them all, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God? His message is greater and is final and authoritative. We are then to listen to him. We're going to look at chapter 3 this morning of Hebrews. And in chapter 3 of Hebrews, the writer continues with his comparisons. He moves his comparison to Moses. He's going to compare Jesus with Moses, and he's going to tell us that Jesus is greater than Moses. Now, with that, you can just imagine, think about what the Jews are going to think or how they're going to respond and retaliate to such a message. The Jews were about to receive the shocking message of their lives. And this shocking message is that actually Moses is the lesser intermediary in comparison to Jesus Christ. Moses was a prominent agent of God's revelation in the Old Testament. He was esteemed by the Jews as the prophet. Deuteronomy 34, verse 10 tells us that no prophet was there like Moses. No prophets have ever arisen, one who could compare to Moses. That's how high they esteemed Moses. That means then that to shift a Jewish mind, to shift a Jew from Moses to someone else is going to be almost impossible. And the writer knew about that impossibility. But the writer also knew that unless a Jew moves from Moses to Jesus, he cannot be saved. Unless they move from Moses to Jesus Christ, there will be no salvation, for there is no salvation in Moses. Now, mind you that this condition is not only true of the Jews, it is also true of every human being. Unless we abandon all our treasured Christless religions and human authorities, we cannot be saved. For Acts 4:12 says, there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. The only name that carries the authority to be saved or to save is the name of Jesus. Jews need Christ. We need Christ to be saved. We see in the book of Acts, that even the Jews who believed in Jesus Christ found it hard to completely let go of Moses. We read in Acts 15, verse 1, that some men came down from Judea. They came to Antioch and began teaching the brethren that unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. The Apostle Paul also faced thousands of Jews in Jerusalem, whom Luke describes as Jews who have believed and are zealous for the law. Luke reports in Acts 21, verse 21, that these Jews have been told that Paul is teaching all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, telling them not to circumcise their children, nor to walk according to the customs. The writer of Hebrews had such Jews in mind when he wrote this letter, the Jews who were still holding on to Moses. Yes, be saved, but don't let go of Moses. That's what these Jews were teaching. Their minds and hearts were on both Jesus and Moses, and they were not willing to let go of Moses, to fully focus on Jesus. But with such competing allegiance came a great danger. If they are not going to hear or listen to Christ as the final word, the writer knew that they would miss the promised rest. They will never enter the rest that Christ has prepared for his people. Because if they are not going to move, then that means their hearts will be hardened to hear Christ when he speaks. And in the hardening of their hearts, the result will be tragic unbelief. And the writer of Hebrews is about to show that. That's actually his main concern here, as we see in verse 12. Look at the exhortation in verse 12, or the warning in verse 12. Of Hebrews 3. Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart, leading you to fall away from the living God. That's the warning he's bringing. Take care. If you're not going to hear Christ, if you're not going to go to Christ, let go of everything else and come to Christ, take care that this is going to happen to you, an evil, unbelieving heart. And in verse 13, but exhort one another every day, as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. And we see also in verse 19, so we see that they were unable to enter because of unbelief. Then what is the writer of Hebrews going to do then? The writer of Hebrews writes this chapter to warn these professing believers of the danger of unbelief. And this is an exhortation we need today. We need to hear this exhortation in order that we may guard our hearts against unbelief, so that we do not miss the promised rest, as we will see from the examples of the Old Testament, those people in the wilderness, or the Israelites in the wilderness, who missed the promised land because of unbelief. So that's the message for us today. Guard your heart against unbelief. You ask, how do I do that? How do we guard our hearts against unbelief? In chapter 3, the writer of Hebrews is giving us three imperatives. There are three imperatives in this chapter that if we make sure that we obey, will help us guard our hearts against unbelief. So I want to bring these imperatives to you this morning. Take them as a remedy. Take them to help you. Obey them in order to help you guard your heart against unbelief. So the first is found in verse 1 of Hebrews chapter 3, and that is, consider Jesus. Consider Jesus. Let me read to you verse 1 to 6 of Hebrews 3. Therefore, holy brothers, you who share in a heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession, who was faithful to him who appointed him, just as Moses also was faithful in all God's house. For Jesus has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, as much more glory as the builder of a house has more honor than the house itself. For every house is built by someone, but the builder of all things is God. Now Moses was faithful in all God's house as a servant to testify to the things that were to be spoken later, but Christ is faithful over God's house as a son. And we are his house if indeed we hold fast our confidence and our boasting in a hope. The imperative is to consider Jesus. We are commanded here in verse 1 to consider Jesus. Now we ask, who should consider Jesus? Look again at verse 1. The writer of Hebrews is calling the holy brothers, those who share in heavenly calling. These are believers. Notice that he begins this chapter with that word, therefore. Therefore, holy brothers, you who share in heavenly calling. Now, if he's asking us to do this, we ask then, who are these holy brothers? How do we become these holy brothers that he would address them as holy brothers who share in the heavenly calling? Well, look back at chapter 2, verse 11, because that's where the therefore actually comes in. It is on the basis of what he said in chapter 2 that he can draw the conclusions in chapter 3. Chapter 2, verse 11, the writer of Hebrews said these words, "For he who sanctifies," and that's Jesus, "and those who are sanctified," that's believers, "all have one source." That is why he is not ashamed to call them brothers. So we have here sanctified brothers in chapter 2, verse 11. Hence, the writer could draw this conclusion in chapter 3, verse 1, and is addressing these believers as holy brothers. Not only holy brothers, but they are sharing in the heavenly calling, and this is the call of salvation. So then we can see that this exhortation or this message coming out is given to professing believers, those who are found in the church, those who confess Jesus Christ. They are the ones who are called to consider Jesus. Now, what does it mean to consider Jesus? Well, the verb consider means to give full attention. It has an idea of discovering something through observation. And its meaning involves giving proper and decisive thought. Emphasis is on the thinking, on the mind. So what is then the writer of Hebrews telling us? Well, the writer of Hebrews is telling us as believers, or is commanding us as believers, never to move away from Jesus, but to have our minds set on him fully. To have our minds focused on him. To have our thoughts thinking about Jesus. And we see that Jesus is the object to be considered. He is the object of our observation. He is the object of our attention. He requires us to give him full attention. We cannot give him half attention. We cannot focus on Moses and focus on Jesus at the same time. We are to shift from all else to Jesus and focus on him alone. So what did the writer then want his readers to consider about Jesus? Well, he wants them to know that Jesus is better, greater, or superior than Moses. And that's what we will see in verses 2 to 6. However, before the writer gets to this important comparison, he gives us three titles of Jesus to consider. So let's consider who Jesus is so that we can know what to think about him. First, let's think about this name Jesus itself. Consider that name, Jesus. We must observe that the main title the writer has used to introduce Jesus to us so far is the title Son. Son. In these last days, God has spoken in his Son, we saw in chapter 1, verse 1. But here in chapter 3, the writer does not say, consider the Son, but consider Jesus. What is the writer doing with that move? Well, the writer moves from the title Son to the name Jesus to help us to not only think of Jesus as God, but also as man. That's what the title Jesus is introducing to us, the humanity of Jesus, the God-man. Consider this God-man, Jesus. We also observe that this is the second time the name Jesus is used in the book of Hebrews so far. The writer used it first in Hebrews 2 verse 9, where he's actually applying Psalm 8 to Jesus. In Hebrews 2 verse 9 we read, but we see him who for a little while was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus, crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. So you can see why he uses the name Jesus. He's using the name Jesus to focus on his humanity. The man Jesus had to suffer. The man Jesus had to taste death. He is the one who was humiliated by coming down into this world and take upon himself the form of a servant, and he humbled himself, as Philippians 2 tells us, to the point of death and even death on the cross. He suffered death so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for us. In chapter 2, verse 14, the writer of Hebrews goes on to say, since therefore the children share in the flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil. You need the God-man, Jesus, to come into this world to defeat Satan, to defeat death, and to defeat sin. So the name Jesus here is connected to his humanity. And this is exactly why Jesus was given this name. For an angel of the Lord told Joseph in Matthew 1:21 concerning Mary, she will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. So first, consider Jesus, the God who became man to save us from our sins. That very same name, Jesus, means Savior. Yeshua, Jesus, the Savior. The writer goes on to describe Jesus with two titles, the Apostle and High Priest of our confession. First, consider that title, Apostle. The term apostle simply means the sent out one. And the term is used in the Bible of both messengers without extraordinary status and those with extraordinary status. Jesus is the messenger with extraordinary status. He was sent by God to fulfill God's mission of salvation. And we see this mission accomplished in the next title, the High Priest. So the word apostle means send. God sent Jesus into this world. He came from heaven into this world, the incarnate Savior, Jesus Christ, taking that form of man, taking the body upon himself, and he came into this world sent from God, and we are consider that he is the high priest as well. The role of Christ as a high priest constitutes most of what is to follow in this book. So we need to pay attention to this, because what you will see as you read the book of Hebrews is more of this role of Christ as the high priest. The writer of Hebrews already hinted on Christ's high priestly role in chapter 1, verse 3, where he says of the Son, after making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of majesty on high. We see the same in chapter 8, verse 1. It says, now the point in what we are saying is this: we have such a high priest, one who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heaven. Let me point this out to you as a side note, especially for your Bible reading. As you read your Bible, you will realize that the Bible presents Christ to us in two different ways: in his humiliation and in his exaltation. With Christ coming down into this world, that's his humiliation. But his raising from the dead and being exalted to the right hand of the majesty on high, that is his exaltation. When you read the New Testament, that's a pattern that you will see. Christ in his humiliation and exaltation still receives glory. He receives glory in coming down into this world, and he takes that priestly role, and he is going to make a propitiation for our sins. How? By dying. That death was a humiliating death, but we know that it is through that death that he can be exalted on high, and that he can actually bring many of us to himself. He made purification for sins, and when that was done, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, exalted. In chapter 2, verse 17 of Hebrews, we also noted that Jesus had to be made like his brothers, that is, becoming man in every respect, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God to make propitiation for the sins of the people, to appease God and to satisfy God. That's what Christ did in his high priestly role. And in Hebrews 9, verse 12, we read, by means of his own blood and not by means of the blood of goats and calves, Christ, the high priest, secured an eternal redemption. Now we ask, with the Westminster Shorter Catechism, in question 25, that catechism asks, how does Christ execute the office of a priest? The answer is, Christ executes the office of a priest in his once offering up of himself as a sacrifice to satisfy divine justice and to reconcile us to God, and in making continual intercession for us. Satisfying justice because we deserved God's wrath. In his high priestly office, Christ made that propitiation. He satisfied God. He appeased the wrath of God. And in doing that, he reconciles us back to God as the mediator between God and man. And he continues to intercede for us in heaven even today as our high priest. We are therefore commanded to consider this Jesus, sent by God, appointed as a high priest to die for our sins. Thus, in these three titles, Jesus, the apostle, and the high priest, we have complete revelation and complete redemption. This truth then takes us back to chapter 1. Where the writer argued that Jesus is the final word of God, for God has spoken in his Son. Now, what do we do then with this Savior, apostle, and the high priest? Well, there again in chapter 3, verse 1, the writer calls him the high priest of our confession. We are called then to confess our sins to him and to confess him as Lord. We confess our faith as when we confess Jesus Christ as Lord, as we confess our sins to him. And once we have made that confession, we hold fast to that confession. Chapter 4, verse 14 tells us to do that. Now in Hebrews 3, verse 2 to 6, the writer makes a comparison between Jesus and Moses so that the Jews will consider Jesus more than Moses. Jesus has more glory than Moses, is what the writer is bringing to the Hebrews. We have already noted that the Jews esteemed Moses highly. They could not talk about the law without thinking about Jesus. They could not talk about deliverance without thinking about Moses. They could not talk about a leader without talking about Moses. Moses was their standard of greatness in every respect. They constantly wanted to kill Jesus for going against Moses, and they wanted to impose the Mosaic law on Gentiles as part of salvation. Therefore, the writer of Hebrews knew that for the Jews to consider Jesus, they need to be more convinced that Jesus is better and greater than Moses. But in doing so, notice that the writer of Hebrews is not going to look down on Moses. He's not going to speak negatively about Moses, because after all, God also spoke highly of his servant Moses. So they were right to hold Moses in that high esteem, because God himself had the same view of Moses. We see that in Numbers 12, verse 6 to 8, where the Lord rebukes Aaron and Miriam, and he said, "Hear my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, make myself known to him in a vision. I speak with him in a dream, not so with my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my house. With him I speak mouth to mouth, clearly and not in riddles." God spoke highly of Moses. The people, the Jews, held Moses in this high regard or esteem. So the writer of Hebrews is also not going to put Moses down. He's not going to speak negatively of Moses. So what does he do? Well, in Hebrews 3 verse 2, the writer looks back to Numbers 12 verse 6 to 8, and he compares Jesus' faithfulness to the faithfulness of Moses, and then acknowledges that Jesus and Moses have this one thing in common. They were both faithful in God's house, both faithful in fulfilling what God has appointed or sent them to do. Hebrews 3:2 reads, "Who," and that's Jesus, the apostle and high priest, "was faithful to him who appointed him, just as Moses also was faithful in all God's house." Well, God's house here refers to God's people. For Moses, it refers back to the Old Testament people, the Israelites, and for Jesus, it will refer to all his people. Both were faithful in God's house, all of God's house. Both Jesus and Moses were appointed as mediators and leaders, and they were faithful in carrying out that role of mediation and leadership. Hebrews 3:16 asks, "For who were those who had yet rebelled? Was it not all those who left Egypt led by Moses?" Moses was a leader, and he led them faithfully. Jesus and Moses were also agents of revelation. That's what we see in common. They were both agents of revelation. For God spoke long ago to Moses, mouth to mouth or face to face. And in these last days, he has spoken to us in his Son. So both were agents of God's revelation. Both Moses and Jesus fulfilled their God appointed roles among God's people. However, by comparison, Jesus is greater than Moses. Have you noticed that the writer of Hebrews is not comparing Jesus with something that could be very low, that could be looked down on, and the people, the Jews, will just think, yeah, we understand that. That is really nothing. No, but he's saying, yeah, Moses is something. He is highly regarded. We understand that he is the standard. But let me show you the one who is even more greater than Moses. And that is Jesus. Hebrews 3, verse 3 to 6, we see these comparisons. Jesus has greater glory. Greater glory. We saw in Hebrews 1 verse 3 that he is the radiance of God's glory. He radiates God. What about Moses? Moses has lesser glory. You read in 2 Corinthians 3 verse 7 to 11, you realize that Moses' glory was fading. Hence he had to put on the veil on him because it would soon be gone and people won't see that glory. But Jesus' glory is permanent. He radiates God. He is God. Whereas Moses reflects God. So take that comparison I used last week of the sun and the moon. Jesus is the sun, he radiates. Moses is the moon, he has to reflect God, the sun's glory. Jesus then is greater in glory, magnificent in glory. Jesus is also likened to a builder, whereas Moses is likened to a house. Yes, Moses was faithful in God's house, but Moses was also part of God's house. Jesus is the architect. He is the perfecter. He is the one who begins and is the one who ends. He is the one who created God's house, God's people. We saw in Hebrews 1 that he created all things and he upholds all things by the word of his power. If that is the case, then we need to go to the builder and not to the house. And we see the writer of Hebrews says that a builder has more honor than the house. The house has a lesser honor. You better honor the one who builds, the one who actually has conceived of the structure and the architecture, and he builds the house more than giving honor to the house itself. And the builder is Jesus. Jesus was faithful as a son. Moses was faithful as a servant. Look at those two comparisons there. We know that the son is the heir, the servant is not. Jesus is greater. And the last comparison we're given is that Jesus was over God's house. Moses was in God's house. Those two prepositions, they are important, over and in. Servant in God's house, son over God's house. The first over is a marker of authority. And the next one in Moses in actually is the area of activity. One serves in that area as a servant. The one is over everything as the son. He is the heir of all things, our Lord Jesus Christ. Is he not greater? The Jews were to see this, that although Moses could be highly regarded, yet there is one who's greater than Moses, and that is Jesus Christ. Why does then the writer of Hebrews tell us all these truths about Jesus? Well, he tells us so that we can consider the Son's greater salvation, consider his perfect redemption, consider his incomparable worth displayed in his glory, consider his authority, and consider that looking to Jesus alone will guard us from hardening our hearts when we hear his voice. The result of that hardness of heart will be an evil, unbelieving heart, as we are warned again in Hebrews 3 verse 12. And this warning then brings us to the writer's second imperative. that we must obey in order to guard our hearts against unbelief. The exposition has been given. We are told about who Jesus is. Then what do we do? Why does he give this? Well, he is giving us that because that is what is going to safeguard us against apostasy. That's what's going to safeguard us against unbelief. We need to know Jesus and consider him in order for our hearts not to be hardened, not to be deceived by sin. So that's the second imperative. And you see that in verses 7 through to 12. This imperative comes as a warning as well. And it is actually the application of the exposition we see in verse 1 to 6. So the second imperative is take care of your heart. If you're going to guard your heart against unbelief, then pay attention to that heart. Take care of your heart. You ask, what's wrong with my heart? What's wrong with my heart that I should take care of? Well, look at verse 7 to 12. Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion on the day of testing in the wilderness, where your fathers put me to the test and saw my works for 40 years. Therefore, I was provoked with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart. They have not known my ways. As I saw in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God. Here in verses 7 to 11, the writer of Hebrews quotes Psalm 95, verse 7 to 11. And he does that to warn us of the deceitfulness of our hearts. We need to take care of our hearts because our hearts can be hardened towards God's word. We say that in verse 7 and 8. If you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. It can be hardened. Our hearts are rebellious against or towards God. In verse 16, we saw that. Our hearts are evil. Verse 12 tells us that. Jeremiah 17, verse 9 tells us that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately sick. Who can understand it? Our hearts are wicked. They are evil. They are deceitful. Our hearts tend towards apostasy as well. We see this in verse 12, unbelieving heart, which can result in falling away from the living God. Our hearts are disobedient, verse 18. That's just the diagnosis of your heart. Everyone's heart, born into this world, we are born with that heart, a rebellious heart. Our hearts are prone to wander. And in our wandering, we provoke God. As Hebrews 10:10 recalls, I was provoked with that generation and said, they always go astray in their heart. They have not known my ways. Our wandering from God, our disobedience, our rebellion, and our hardness of heart provokes God's anger and wrath. The Bible says, as a result, the people in the wilderness missed their promised land. They missed the promised land. Verse 11, as I saw in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. In verse 18, the writer of Hebrews asks, and to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest? But to those who were disobedient. So we see that they were unable to enter because of unbelief. Verse 19. As such, brothers and sisters, is the true nature of the heart of man. A deceived heart, a heart deceived by sin is just like that. For sin hardens your heart so that you do not hear God's voice when he speaks in his Son. And that hardness results in apostasy, leading you to fall away from the living God. Notice that the writer is saying falling away from the living God. Why that adjective living? Because when you fall away, you don't just fall away to nothing. You fall away to a different God, because moving from God is actually embracing a different God of any kind. Don't fall away from this God because of the hardness of heart. Now let me answer the question that I know is in your mind right now. You are asking, does this mean I can lose my salvation? Let me talk to the Calvinists in our midst. Well, the answer is no. You cannot lose your salvation. Why? Because if you are saved, it means that when you heard the voice of God, you did not harden your heart. So then you have nothing to worry about. If you know that you had God speaking to you, and you responded by faith to God who spoke to you in His Son, you did not harden your heart, you are saved. So you have nothing to worry about. So then you ask, who is the writer then of Hebrews concerned about? Well, verses 6 and verse 14 help us to see this. The people is concerned about. Look at verse 6, Hebrews 3. Verse 6 says, and indeed, if we are His house, if indeed we hold fast our confidence and are boasting in our hope, or indeed we are His house, if indeed we hold fast our confidence. So what makes us then God's people? If we hold fast our confidence and are boasting in our hope. We have confidence, we have boasting in hope, in Christ. Verse 14 says, for we have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original confidence firm to the end. Now these two verses speak about the perseverance of the saints. Those who are truly saved and are united with Christ by faith will persevere to the end. Why? Because they are kept by the power of God. That's why. The Son of God, who upholds all things by His powerful word, Hebrews 1 verse 3, will also uphold their salvation. Your salvation is in God's hand. You will persevere because He is keeping you. So then, who is the writer of Hebrews concerned about? He's concerned about those who will not persevere to the end. And not persevering to the end is a sign of someone who just professes his mouth but is not truly saved. See, the writer of Hebrews knows that in his congregation he does have such people. He has people who are hearing God's word and they are not accepting it or embracing it by faith. But as they continue to hear God's word, they keep on hardening their hearts. They profess, they claim to be part of, but yet whenever difficulties come, they do not persevere. They do not hold on to the confidence and the boasting in their hope. They do not hold on to Christ. Such are the people that this writer is concerned about. So perseverance then is the only way you will know if you indeed belong to the house of Christ, according to Hebrews 3:6, and if indeed you have come to share in Christ, in Hebrews 3:14, by perseverance. But if your heart is hardened towards God's word, is rebellious towards God, and is evil, disobedient, and does not believe Jesus as the Savior who gave His life on the cross and rose from the dead to make you right with God, then be warned that you have an unbelieving heart that will lead you to withdrawing or denouncing the living God. And that's what it means to fall away from the living God. You are an apostate if you deny Jesus as the only means of salvation. And you deny Jesus if you think you can be made right with God without his son's mediation. If you think you can be made right with God without Christ, you're denying Christ. You are sacrificing him for the second time. You are trampling underfoot the blood of Jesus Christ. There is no way you will be saved without Jesus Christ. So with this warning in mind, we must then take the final imperative the writer gives us to guard our hearts against unbelief as an urgent matter. We need to take this final imperative as an urgent matter. So we are called to consider Jesus and to take care of our hearts lest we are hardened by sin and we fall into that unbelief. So what then are we to do? Well, here's an urgent matter in verse 13. And this is the final imperative the writer gives us to guard our hearts against unbelief. Exhort one another. We are called to exhort one another. We live with each other. We watch each other. We can see that perhaps this one is steeping towards that hardness of heart and unbelief because God's word is preached, his voice is clearly heard, yet you are not following or pursuing to hold on to Christ. The writer of Hebrews says in these final verses from verse 13 to 19, but exhort one another every day as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we have come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original confidence firm to the end. As it is said today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion. For who were those who had and yet rebelled? Was it not all those who left Egypt led by Moses? And with whom was he provoked for 40 years? Was it not with those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? And to whom did he swear that they would not enter his rest, but to those who were disobedient? So we see that they were unable to enter because of unbelief. We are urged to exhort one another. And let me be the first one to obey this command today and exhort you right now to consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession. I urge you to see the danger of being hardened by the deceitfulness of sin, for it will prevent you from entering the rest that Christ prepared for his children. This is an urgent matter. Please consider him today. If I were to plead with you, you cannot afford to postpone this day of salvation. You cannot. Behold, my friend, Paul says, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Today, the Bible says, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. Here's the danger, especially for us who live in the 21st century, with all the things that we rely on to cause us to think that tomorrow will come. Here is the danger, that we postpone salvation because we think we will see tomorrow. I think that I can quickly go and see a doctor and if I can fix whatever ailment I have and I will be able at least to see tomorrow or next week or next year. But the Bible knows nothing about tomorrow when it comes to salvation. The day of salvation is now. The day of coming to Christ is today because you cannot be guaranteed tomorrow. You can face your Savior, or your Creator today. Will you be right with him when you face him? The warning is that they made it to that point close to the border of the promised land, and they all died in the wilderness. They missed the promised land. Why? Because of unbelief and the hardness of heart. Today, when you hear this voice, do not harden your heart. Take example from them and turn to Christ today, my friend. Today is an acceptable time. Today is the day of salvation. There will be no other. Don't postpone this. It's an urgent matter. Come to Jesus today. Hebrews 4:1 says, while the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it, because you can fail. He doesn't want any of us. Let there be no one among you who will be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin and fall away from the living God. Do not be that person. Turn your eyes and mind fully upon Jesus. For if he is better than Moses, whom God highly regarded, then he is even far much better and greater and glorious than anything that is keeping you from coming to him. Come now, today. But be warned, if you choose to continue in unbelief, just as the Israelites hardened their hearts in the wilderness, you will not enter God's rest. As the bodies of those unbelievers fell in the wilderness, so shall you face the eternal wrath of God. Only those who believe in him as their Lord and Savior will enter God's rest. But for those of you who have considered and trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, I exhort you, hold on to your confession to the end. Persevere, knowing that he is able to keep you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory blameless with great joy. Take care of your heart. Look to Jesus and trust him as your Lord and Savior. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word this morning. And we pray that we will not look at anything and give it our allegiance, but that, oh Jesus, we will worship you alone. That you will reign in our hearts, and that you alone, oh God, will be the master of our lives. We have heard you speak today. Will you come and change our hearts? Will the Holy Spirit apply this truth to our hearts, lest we miss the rest, as we see that millions of people died in that wilderness and they missed the promised land? Please, Lord, have mercy on us and save us today. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Consider Jesus.